Halloween 6 screenwriter Daniel Farrens would make one final contribution to the franchise during its filming, delivering a treatment for what he envisioned as Halloween 7, a concept he titled Michael Myers, Lord of the Dead, intending it to be a direct follow-up to the sixth film, what he called the second half. The film would pick up immediately after the events of The Curse of Michael Myers and once again focus on Paul Rudd's Tommy Doyle, seeing him uncover a massive Haddonfield conspiracy involving the Shape and the town citizens, one that would further build upon the Curse of Thorn mythology. Farrens likened this concept to The Wicker Man meets The Hitcher, Rosemary's Baby, and Shirley Jackson's The Lottery, as well as borrowing heavily from screenwriter Dennis Etchison's original rejected screenplay for Halloween 4, which shared a similar storyline. However, following the outright butchering that took place during the production of Halloween 6, Farrens decided that he couldn't bear to see another one of his scripts get creatively slaughtered, and later bowed out of the franchise altogether. With no writer and a lukewarm box office and critical reception from their most recent effort, Trunkus International head Mustafa Akkad and distributor Dimension Films would choose to push forward on the seventh Halloween sequel with a clean slate. Of course, desperate to make the franchise relevant again and, as always, perhaps even reach the lofty heights of its now classic originator. A showdown 20 years in the making. Despite seeking a return to form, ambitions for the sequel would be tempered, and the project was initially launched as a strictly straight-to-video venture, Dimension choosing to err on the side of caution and relegate the seventh film to the home video market, minimizing their financial risk. And in their search for a fresh and exciting outing for their prized IP, then relatively unknown television writer and USC graduate Robert Zappia would boldly place his head on the Hollywood chopping block. Zappia had submitted an original science fiction screenplay to the studio that, while ultimately unproduced, would quickly catch their attention, and the young writer was swiftly scooped out of obscurity and contracted to write his first major studio film, even if it would premiere at Blockbuster Video. Zappia said at the time that he considered the opportunity to be an honor. By July 1997, Zappia would submit a treatment titled Halloween 7, Two Faces of Evil, later retitled Halloween Blood Ties. His pitch finding Michael Myers supposedly found dead in Smith's Grove Sanitarium, and later coming back to life to stalk the halls of an all-girls boarding school, a setting that would more or less carry over to the final film. On the other hand, at the insistence of longtime series producer Paul Freeman, Zappia's script also revealed the existence of a copycat Shape, with a very interesting backstory, a notion that made Dimension Films executives extremely nervous. More on that later. Zappia would spend weeks laboring over endless drafts, until one day Dimension Films founder Bob Weinstein called the young writer to his office to inform him that his little straight-to-video movie was about to become a genre-redefining event. There are really two different accounts about how exactly the film as we know it came into conception. According to Malik Akkad, while executives at Dimension Films were kicking around ideas about how to make Halloween 7 into something truly special, it would be Bob Weinstein himself who would spark the idea of Halloween heroine Laurie Strode returning to the series, knowing full well that fans would clamor to see the long overdue revenge of Michael's estranged sister. Akkad added that Weinstein then personally approached former series star Jamie Lee Curtis about joining the project. Alternatively, Curtis had said that she and John Carpenter, as well as producer Deborah Hill, had spoken about the idea of an anniversary film before the studio became involved. Really, the whole timeline is a bit unclear. Regardless of who sparked the idea, by this point in Curtis's career, she was more than ready and willing to make her long-awaited return to Summer Glen. And seemingly overnight, the production emerged from the murky depths of straight-to-video-dom into one of the most talked-about films of the summer 1998 movie season. And first-time screenwriter Robert Zappia would now be tasked with making it all come together.
The buses leave for Yosemite at 4:15 sharp.
Why aren't you going camping, Miss Tate?
Because it sounds like fun.
We did Yosemite. It means we could have a Halloween party, just the four of us.
God, I can't believe we're doing this.
Look, Mom, help me out here. I need a little more open air. I've earned it. Look, I know today is the day, but I think...
Oh, really? What day is that, John?
Halloween.
I hadn't noticed.
Look, Mom, we're through with all that.
No!
There's a backstory that I haven't been... completely successful.
They locked him up for a long time, but he got out and he came after me, but I got away. But he killed a lot of my friends.
Come on, man, let's go.
It happened on Halloween. You've heard the story.
Who hasn't? Michael Myers.
Hello?
It's like 20 years ago, right?
1978.
And the girl that... What happened to the sister? She died, right?
No, she faked her death.
Michael Myers. Yeah, right.
The seventh film in the franchise would not only herald the return of Jamie Lee Curtis as Laurie Strode, but also the esteemed actor's return to the horror genre itself, unless you count erotic thrillers. Her last appearance in a horror film having been 1981's Halloween 2. She also did voice work for Halloween 3, but let's not split hairs. Curtis's absence in the genre was very much a conscious decision. Having widely gained the nickname Scream Queen by the early 1980s, the rising star was concerned about becoming typecast and hitting a career slump, adding that she struggled to find roles after 1978's Halloween, and eventually chose to retire from the throne. But evidently, not give up the crown. On her return to the role, Curtis said that she felt secure enough in herself and her status as an actor to step back into the world of horror filmmaking, and that enough time had passed to justify it. Curtis added that she also thought the film would be a love letter to fans of the series and saw it as a kind of anniversary celebration, adding that she wouldn't have had an acting career if it weren't for her horror movie roots. Halloween H20 would mark the actor's third appearance as the beloved character. Curtis's return, of course, would not be without its stipulations, namely, heavy creative input. And before she even had officially agreed to board the project, the actor went to work putting together her creative dream team. But first, we've gotta talk about Scream.
Because he's probably dead, his body will come popping up in the last reel somewhere. Eyes gouged out, fingers cut off, teeth knocked out. See, the police are always off track with this shit. If they'd watch prom night, they'd save time. There's a formula to it. A very simple formula. Everybody's a suspect.
...1996's Scream, while partially satirical, was, in its time, perhaps the most successful entry in slasher movie cinema in recent memory, and would usher in an onslaught of tonally and stylistically similar films, each capitalizing on the public interest that swelled around the subgenre through the late 90s and into the early 2000s, essentially solidifying the newborn series as Dimension Films' most valuable asset. And so, perhaps inevitably, the shadow of Dimension's other white-faced killer franchise would fall long over the production of the seventh Halloween installment. Enter screenwriter Kevin Williamson. Williamson had not only developed and written the scripts for Scream and Scream 2, but the busy writer had also adapted I Know What You Did Last Summer in 1997, and 1998 would see the release of his high school alien horror film The Faculty and his premier TV teen drama, Dawson's Creek. Fortunately, Jamie Lee Curtis was game to play ball with the studio writer, and she and director Steve Miner would work closely with Williamson to make further changes to Robert Zappia's script, often fine-tuning character details, fleshing out the more emotional scenes, and fixing plot holes and gaps in logic where new ideas now clashed. While Williamson would not receive a writing credit on the final film, Writers Guild rules dictating that one must contribute at least 33% of a screenplay in order to be credited for it, he would still continue to be significantly involved with the sequel's production, providing further real-time rewrites to the script while on set, primarily to the teen character's dialogue, as well as continuing to help pitch new ideas. Because the studio had hoped to market the film as from the creator of Scream, Dimension Films offered original screenwriter Robert Zappia an undisclosed amount of money to share the writing credit with Williamson, but Zappia refused their offer. As a concession, they ultimately handed Williamson the sometimes meaningless moniker of executive producer. From the onset, Jamie Lee Curtis hoped to reunite the original crew from the 1978 production, and so naturally John Carpenter himself was courted to direct the reboot. Despite his differences with Akkad and Dimension Heads Bob and Harvey Weinstein, Carpenter was willing to give the franchise another shot, but with a caveat. He demanded a hefty $10 million salary, claiming it would be compensation for unpaid revenue he was owed from the original film's box office, in addition to a three-picture deal with a studio. However, both the Akkads and the Weinsteins balked at Carpenter's proposal and swiftly rejected the offer, effectively killing the idea of the filmmaker ever directing a Halloween film again. Disappointed by Carpenter's exit, but not deterred, Curtis, of course, next turned to her friend and creative collaborator, director Steve Miner, who she had previously worked with on 1992 sci-fi drama Forever Young. Miner also being somewhat of a safe choice for the studio, given his proximity to another fan-favorite slasher franchise, and his other extensive experience in the genre. The then 47-year-old filmmaking veteran was best known for having helmed Friday the 13th Parts 2 and 3, as well as the 1980s cult classics House and Warlock, and would see his crocodile horror comedy Lake Placid released the following year. Interestingly enough, Lake Placid had actually been greenlit before H20, but Miner decided that the weather in British Columbia would be too rough for filming at that time of year and pushed the production to the summer of 98. Miner admitted that he hadn't seen any of the Halloween sequels when he was hired.
Action! Action!
With its cast and crew in place, On a budget of $17 million, principal photography would kick off in Calabasas, California, marking a major departure from the previous three films' Salt Lake City backdrop. And extensive on-location filming would later take place at the Canfield Marino Estate near Silver Lake, an extravagant hilltop mansion that once belonged to silent film star Antonio Marino, here doubling for the fictional high school Hillcrest Academy. Most exteriors would be captured in the small town of La Puente, California, Summer Glen's Main Street, located about 20 miles outside of downtown Los Angeles. And the film is, to date, the only entry in the series to not take place in Haddonfield, including both Rob Zombie remakes, but obviously not including Halloween 3. This concept was primarily the vision of Dimension Films executives, who hoped to breathe new life into the series by giving the shape new stocking grounds. Almost all interior filming would take place at Stage 24 on the Universal Studios backlot.
Hey, there's a couple things in there.
Miner would bring with him his frequent collaborator, cinematographer Darren Okada. And Miner and Okada had hoped to shoot the sequel with a widescreen anamorphic lens, following in the steps of original franchise cinematographer Dean Cundey. To their disappointment, no such lenses were available to the production at the time, and so they were forced to shoot the film in Super 35 instead, but still composed the shots for the anamorphic 2.351 aspect ratio. 41, one mark. Steve Miner recalled that during filming, he had received a 2 a.m. phone call from a frantic Jamie Lee Curtis. The actor worried about the quality of the script and the direction the story was taking, the director having promised the star that he would, quote, fix the original script before shooting. Both Miner and Curtis would later agree that writer Kevin Williamson's uncredited efforts ultimately salvaged the film from disaster. Halloween H20 would be the first in the series to be slated for a summer release, a trend that would continue until 2018. Shooting would officially conclude on April 20th, 1998, just 4 months before its world premiere. We open in Langdon, Illinois, catching up with Dr. Loomis's former colleague, Nurse Marion Chambers, who arrives at the late doctor's home to find the house being burglarized, and seeks help in the form of the teenage neighbor boy, stick-happy hockey enthusiast Jimmy Howell, here played by a 17-year-old Joseph Gordon-Levitt.
No shit.
Jimmy's hockey mask is an obvious nod to Jason Voorhees, Steve Miner having directed the film that introduces Jason's favorite youth-slaughtering facewear. After giving the house a thorough once-over, Jimmy clears the scene and sends Nurse Chambers to her certain death. And noticeably, the file on Laurie Strode has gone missing.
Hasn't anyone told you? Secondhand smoke kills.
Yeah, but they're all dead.
Of course, Jamie Lee Curtis was not the only original Halloween actor to revisit the franchise. Nancy Stevens here returning to the fan-favorite role of Nurse Marion Chambers for her third appearance as the character. Here, the character is given the added surname Whittington and still maintains her signature smoking habit. While Stevens' return as Nurse Chambers was warmly welcomed by fans, the character was not always featured in the film's opening, writer Kevin Williamson originally having conceived of starting the film with a totally new, short-lived character, similar to Scream, giving Dr. Samuel Loomis a daughter named Rachel, who would have kept her father's files on Laurie and Michael. A subplot involving two detectives investigating the murder of Nurse Chambers was also cut, including a minor role for actor Charles S. Dutton, who had been cast before the major rewrites took place. However, remnants of these characters still remain in the pre-credit sequence. The younger detective in this scene is played by Matt Winston, son of the late special effects legend Stan Winston, who would also play a role in the production. This orchestral take on John Carpenter's Halloween theme that plays over the opening titles is one of just a few untouched pieces remaining in the final film from composer John Ottman's original score, and the theme he was most proud of. A lot more on this in a bit. The filmmakers wanted to include Dr. Loomis's Myers House speech to Sheriff Brackett from the first film, but were unable to recover the original unmixed audio and, therefore, were forced to recreate the monologue. At the recommendation of the film's editor, Patrick Lussier, voice talent Tom Kane was brought in to bring to life the late Donald Pleasance for one last performance. According to Kane, the studio was so dedicated to getting the voice right that they brought in the late actor's best friend to sit in on the recording session to help point Kane in the right direction, a process Kane found to be extremely challenging, requiring almost 50 takes to gain approval. The film would be dedicated to the memory of Donald Pleasance. The newspaper clipping seen in this montage were originally meant to be one of the film's strongest links to the events of parts 4 through 6, with the paper showing headlines such as "Mysterious Cult Kept Murders Hushed Up in Haddonfield" and "Jamie Lloyd Missing." However, even at the time of shooting, the producers were indecisive about whether or not the film should fully acknowledge the previous three sequels, and this alternative opening was later replaced for the final version, with only a couple of vague references to the previous sequels still visible. We find Laurie Strode living a new life, going under the name Carrie Tate, and still coping with the events of Halloween Night, 1978. Now the headmaster of a prestigious high school, she struggles to keep her rebellious son, John, safe from his lunatic uncle. And an upcoming Halloween night school trip to Yosemite National Park brings these tensions to a head.
I just need this one thing.
Mama, I am not responsible for you!
Curtis wanted Laurie's life to be in total shambles at the start of the film, feeling the character needed to be at rock bottom, and had even planned to play Laurie as a raging alcoholic, which remains in the film but is much more toned down. Curtis and the studio didn't see eye to eye on the direction of the character, and middleman Steve Miner had to work hard to convince the star that Laurie needed to have even more to lose. At one point, the film held the title Halloween 7, The Revenge of Laurie Strode, an obvious play on The Revenge of Michael Myers, and writer Kevin Williamson had proposed maintaining the continuity of the previous Michael films, essentially retconning Laurie's death in Halloween 4 by writing her as having faked her death in the car accident and assuming a new identity, a concept that obviously stuck. Williamson's additions would also have included flashbacks to parts 4, 5, and 6, as well as showing Laurie's reaction to learning of Jamie Lloyd's death. Williamson would also write Laurie as having entered the witness protection program with her son, an idea that would also fail to make the final cut in its entirety, although it is still vaguely alluded to. Then totally unknown 19-year-old actor Josh Hartnett would win the role of Laurie's troubled son, John Tate, marking Halloween H20 as his feature film debut, and the quiet no-name actor would soon after be catapulted into the limelight. Following the film's release, Hartnett would become a 90s heartthrob seemingly overnight, exploding into fame with the release of H20 and Kevin Williamson's The Faculty, released just 4 months later. In fact, The Faculty and H20 were actually shot concurrently, meaning that Hartnett was bouncing back and forth between sets throughout filming. Hartnett was at first hesitant to audition for the role, worried about what Halloween 7 would look like on his resume, and also concerned about the film going straight to video at the time. However, once he learned that original star Jamie Lee Curtis had signed on to the project, he leapt at the opportunity. Hartnett would also get into some trouble with the hair and makeup department, as he hated the cookie-cutter boy-next-door look the stylists were aiming for. And in an act of defiance, he would not only regularly mess up his hair before takes and wear a beanie in between shots, but the actor also continually cut his own hair in order to sabotage their efforts. Elsewhere nearby, a mother takes her young daughter to use the world's creepiest restroom, and there they have a close encounter with the shape. Who steals their car? Truly, the face of evil. This frightening rest stop sequence was the first thing shot, filmed all in one day at a real rest stop in Malibu Creek State Park. And according to Michael Myers actor Chris Durand, the little girl was so frightened at the sight of the actor in costume that it took director Steve Miner over an hour to convince her to continue the scene. Laurie settles on allowing John to go to Yosemite, but unbeknownst to her, he and his friends have plotted to stay behind for a secret alcohol-fueled Halloween hangout at the academy. And even before the sun sets, Michael Myers arrives in Summer Glen.
Oh! Oh! Oh!
Damn it!
Oh!
The late legendary actor Janet Leigh, star of Psycho and mother of Jamie Lee Curtis, would be cast as Laurie/Carrie's secretary, Norma Watson, being the first of several references to the Alfred Hitchcock classic. Here, the score references Bernard Herrmann's theme for Psycho, and Norma's car is the same car Marion Crane purchases in the 1960 film, including having the same license plate. Norma's line to Laurie,
"Everyone's entitled to one good scare,"
is said by Sheriff Brackett to Laurie in the 1978 original. This was Leigh's first feature film role in over 18 years, her last role having been in John Carpenter's The Fog, oddly enough also starring Jamie Lee Curtis, making Halloween H2O the third time they have shared the screen together. Before Leigh was offered the role, original Halloween co-star PJ Souls was first approached to cameo as Laurie's secretary, Norma Watson being the name of her character in 1976's Carrie. However, Souls waffled on the opportunity, unsure if she wanted to return in a different role, and was eventually passed over entirely. That night, school security guard Ronnie finds a strange abandoned vehicle at the gate, and Laurie gets her second scare of the night, this time from her boyfriend/colleague, Will Brennan. In this next scene, Will checks in on Molly and Sarah, where a clip from Scream 2 can be seen playing on the TV. But according to Mustafa Akkad, on the day of filming, the actors were actually watching the 1993 comedy So I Married an Axe Murderer, which starred actor Mike Myers, making for a subtle joke. But, of course, it didn't stop there, as both Jamie Lee Curtis and Steve Miner lobbied to have the Austin Powers star make an actual walk-on cameo appearance in the film, but Myers allegedly wanted nothing to do with it and passed on the opportunity.
Just checking on the Hillcrest remains. You girls okay?
Good. Thanks, Mr. Brennan.
And how are you, Mr. Brennan? Looking cute as ever.
Thank you, Sarah.
Award-winning actor and director Adam Arkin would be cast in a supporting role as Laurie's doomed boyfriend, Will Brennan. Arkin was best known for having starred as Dr. Aaron Schutt on the popular TV medical drama Chicago Hope, and would immediately follow director Steve Miner over to the production of Lake Placid at the end of shooting.
Will do.
If you need anything, contact me or Miss Tate, okay?
Thanks, Mr. Brennan.
Michelle Williams was just 18 years old when cast as John Tate's girlfriend, Molly Cartwell. In earlier versions, Molly was written as being somewhat of an ugly duckling and having a mad crush on John Tate, but afraid to tell him, and was originally intended to be killed by Michael. Williams admitted that she hadn't seen any of the Halloween films at the time she accepted the role. Over the course of filming, the young actor would form a close bond with co-star Jamie Lee Curtis over their mutual love of reading, even gifting Curtis a first edition print of an unnamed classic. While Laurie reveals the truth of her past to Will, John and his friends sneak back into the school, and an eager Charlie volunteers to fetch the booze, which of course is a slasher movie death sentence. The character of Charlie, here played by former child actor Adam Hanbird, would have very different origins from the Randy slasher bait we see on screen. As mentioned earlier, in writer Robert Zappia's original script for Halloween 7, he had introduced the character of a copycat killer, who he'd named Charlie, the character intended to be used in a kind of Hannibal Lecter-esque role, and aiding the police in tracking down Michael. Charlie would also be revealed to be the offspring of a nurse who was sexually assaulted by Michael in his days at the sanitarium. At one point, Zappia named this incarnation of the film Halloween, the Son of Michael Myers, and it was pretty much the story they were going with right up until Jamie Lee Curtis said yes to returning. Originally, Hanbird had been cast to play Michael's creepy killer's son, but of course the script would undergo heavy rewrites between him earning the role and the start of principal photography. When the phones go out, Laurie becomes privy to Michael's presence, and shortly after, discovers that John and his friends have stayed behind, and teams up with Will and Ronnie to track the teens down. Back at the school, Sarah discovers her boyfriend's body, and, in a particularly harrowing scene, Michael, always one for the theatrics, turns her into a human jack-o'-lantern. Actor, model, and fashion designer Jodie Lynn O'Keefe was stunned when she won the role of Sarah Wainthrope, being a huge fan of the franchise at the time. Then 20 years old, O'Keefe was best known for playing Cassidy Bridges in the popular Don Johnson starring police drama Nash Bridges, and Halloween H20 would mark her feature film debut. The character of Sarah was originally written as being quite combative and underhanded toward our protagonists, but this dynamic was obviously later dropped. After discovering Sarah's illuminated corpse, John and Molly have a frightening run-in with Michael, and after a couple of close calls, are rescued by Lori, who once again finds herself face to face with pure evil. Jamie Lee Curtis famously does not like watching horror films and stated that even after 20 years, seeing Michael Myers on set for the first time gave her chills. Lori takes John and Molly to temporary safety, but Will refuses to leave her side and mistakenly guns down Ronnie. Unfortunately, moments later, Michael again crashes the party. As cold as it sounds, according to Malik Akkad, Dimension Films market research showed that the demographic of Black Americans heavily favored the Halloween franchise, and wanting to maximize their financial potential in that market, it was decided to cast a popular Black entertainer in a primary role. Their first choice would be celebrated rapper, record producer, and actor James Todd Smith, aka LL Cool J. Smith admitted that he was a longtime fan of the series, adding that his mother had taken him to see the original film in cinemas when he was just 9 years old. The entertainer had been looking to turn his musical career into an acting one, and at the time was even starring in his own family sitcom, In the House. While Ronnie isn't exactly a fleshed-out character, and in fact was first written as a woman named Hattie who was intended to be killed by Michael, Smith is excellent in the role and provides much of the film's comic relief, some of which was improvised by the performer. Smith would go by his middle name Todd while on set, and the younger actors stated that they were at first completely starstruck by their legendary co-star. Lori and the teens barely escape with their lives, and at the gate, she insists that they go on without her. Here, stunt coordinator Donna Keegan, who was also Jamie Lee Curtis's stunt double, broke her foot when the vehicle's anti-lock brakes snapped back on her unexpectedly, meriting a trip to the hospital. Arming herself with a fire axe, Lori goes back to confront Michael, who, as always, quickly gets the upper hand. Michael's creepy one-armed descent in this scene would not be scripted, and instead was manufactured on the day of filming, Steve Miner and director of photography Darren Okada wanting to find a way to put Michael's incredible strength on full display. After a bloody skirmish, the hunter becomes the hunted when Lori springs a trap on her killer brother. Lori retrieves the knife for one last blow, but an unexpectedly alive Ronnie prevents her from finishing the job. Of course, she knows from experience that it isn't really over, and later steals the ambulance carrying Michael's body from the scene. Michael, as predicted, again comes to life, Lori sending him through the windshield and, in an act of desperation, takes herself, Michael, and the van over the cliffside. The film's climax, which makes up nearly a third of the total runtime, would become a major point of contention for the filmmakers. Early on, Jamie Lee Curtis made it very clear that she sought to have the seventh film put a definitive end to the series, killing off the shape once and for all. However, Mustafa Akkad and Trancas International's contract not only legally prevented him from permanently killing Michael Myers, the ambitious producer, naturally, was also looking forward to making even more sequels after Part 7. To complicate things further, Dimension Films boss Bob Weinstein also wanted the shape to meet his final demise, putting the writers at the center of a sticky dilemma. Allegedly, Weinstein went as far as to demand that writer Robert Zappia produce two opposing endings for the film, the one where Michael survives being handed to Akkad, and the one where he dies being the one that was actually shot. Fortunately, Zappia refused to participate in Weinstein's scheme, and in the end, of course, it was Kevin Williamson who saved the day, coming up with an ending that appeased both parties. The audience thinks the shape is dead, and Akkad could keep making his movies. And so it was that the day after the completion of principal photography, additional footage would be shot that indeed showed Michael having survived the beheading, apparently having pulled the old switcheroo with a paramedic back at the school. While this tacked-on ending would not make the final cut, it would of course be repurposed for the film's 2002 follow-up. Williamson's brilliant solution would all but save the production from disaster, as Curtis had threatened to walk if the audience didn't believe that Michael was truly dead by the end of the film. According to writer Matt Greenberg, who had also completed revisions of Robert Zappia's script and would receive credit on the final film, it was Bob Weinstein who suggested that Laurie behead Michael with an axe. In earlier drafts, Zappia would have Michael pinned between a retractable gym floor over a pool and impaled through the heart with a javelin by Laurie. And in another version, the ending took on a big-budget Mission Impossible-like turn, featuring a helicopter school bus chase sequence that ended with Michael going off a cliff in the bus. What may be the most notable difference, however, is the absence of Laurie's son, John, who had otherwise been included in most previous versions of the final scene. Zappia also intended Michael to utter his first word in the franchise's history, saying Laurie's name as he reaches out in mercy, but this was eventually deleted as it conflicted with the later reveal that this wasn't really Michael. Actor, producer, and stunt professional Chris Durand would be cast as Michael Myers, making him the sixth actor to officially inherit the role after the first film. Then age 35, Durand was slightly younger than the character himself, being born in 1963, the same year a young Michael murdered his sister on Halloween night. At the time of casting, Durand knew very little about the series or its boogeyman, something he felt aided him in making the role a little more his own and helped him avoid any nerves about playing such a popular character. Durand said that he had used the image of a big cat locking onto its prey as guidance for his creepy mannerisms as the shape. But according to cast and crew, having Durand under the mask helped set them at ease. As a stunt performer, Durand was hot off the success of Wes Craven's Scream 2, there playing the killer Ghostface in an uncredited role, and would also go to space for Michael Bay that same year in 1998's Armageddon. Interestingly enough, this is the Halloween film where Michael arguably sustains the least amount of serious damage, being struck and stabbed with a fire poker at the beginning of the film, taking a rock to the face and a knee to the groin, axed in the chest and speared by a flagpole, and is stabbed a few times for good measure. All right, let's talk about that mask. Three weeks into principal photography, Mustafa Akkad and Dimension Films decided that Michael's mask was inadequate and needed to be totally redesigned. Subsequently, additional filming would take place to reshoot almost all sequences featuring the shape thus far. As a result, Michael can be seen wearing at least two obviously different masks in several scenes throughout the film. And according to the late makeup effects artist John Carl Beekler, co-founder of K&B Effects, a total of four distinctly different masks would be used for the film. One was, of course, the original mask, which emphasized a more featureless, smooth approach to Michael's face. However, studio executives thought that it had too much of an ethereal quality and looked like a space alien, and so K&B was commissioned to design a replacement mask, crafted by Beekler himself. This mask would heavily draw from the mask used in The Curse of Michael Myers, and ended up only being used in the film's opening sequence. Unfortunately, the studio was also unhappy with this iteration, and it too was rejected. Contrary to popular belief, the third mask, briefly visible during Charlie's confrontation with Michael, is the Beekler mask enhanced with CGI to look more like the mask ultimately used in the final film, but not completely CGI as has often been purported. This shot was completed on the cheap and at the last minute, with no time or money remaining for proper reshoots. The final mask would at last be designed by award-winning effects artist Stan Winston, and is the mask seen most predominantly in the final film. Nevertheless, this mask too would receive its fair share of criticism from fans. While Winston's studio had designed the mask to bear a closer resemblance to the original, many commented on its awkward tight fit and wide eye openings, clearly revealing Michael's eyes where previous masks had been designed to hide them. Others found the mask's tall and messy hair to be kind of dopey looking and too much of a departure from the more slicked back hair fans had become accustomed to. And in an instance of major oversight, director Steve Miner had not been informed of any of the displeasure and redesign surrounding Michael's mask, and was just a tad bit livid when a new mask showed up on set along with a reconfigured shooting schedule. In fact, the entire last week of filming would be devoted to Duran's reshoots, mainly close-up shots, and would end up costing the production an additional $2 million when all was said and done. Fun fact! The intimidating knife Michael uses in the film is a 14-inch steel Wusthof chef knife. Cuts like butter every time. Longtime franchise composer Alan Howarth would bow out for the seventh series installment after his score was reworked without his knowledge during post-production for Halloween 6, rightfully feeling betrayed by the producers. Unfortunately, Howarth's replacement, then 38-year-old film composer John Ottman, would see history repeated tenfold. Prior to production, Steve Miner had lobbied to hire the great Jerry Goldsmith to score the film, having worked with the famed composer on Warlock and 1992's Forever Young, hoping to give the film an old-fashioned Bernard Herrmann-like sound, Goldsmith also having composed 1983's Psycho 2. However, the studio wanted a much less traditional and younger sound for the film, and John Ottman seemed to fit the bill. The young composer had exploded onto the scene with 1995's The Usual Suspects, and had composed his first horror film the previous year with 1997's dark fairy tale, Snow White, A Tale of Terror. Ottman would work closely with Miner to develop the score, veering away from the more simplistic jarring cues of most slasher cinema, and instead providing a more complex, heavily orchestral composition. Unfortunately, then-Dimension Films chief Harvey Weinstein was dissatisfied with Ottman's final submission, feeling it lacked the energy the film needed to pack a summer-worthy punch at the box office, while editor Patrick Lussier said it was too busy and not very well suited to a Halloween movie. Therefore, unbeknownst to Ottman, and while Steve Miner had already gone off to begin work on Lake Placid, the Weinsteins brought in an entire army of music editors with just 5 days left before the film was set for distribution, and put them to work at Skywalker Sound to completely rework Ottman's original composition, aiming to remold the score into something closer to Dimension's Scream films, hoping to replicate their lucrative formula in every possible way. What's more, music would be directly lifted from composer Marco Beltrami's scores for Scream 1 and 2, as well as his work on Guillermo del Toro's 1997 insect horror film Mimic, used primarily to ramp up the chase sequences and jump scares. Additionally, the producers would bring in Beltrami himself to create new cues for the film, further altering Ottman's score. What scraps remained of the composer's original music were also shuffled around and used in scenes they had not been composed for. According to Lussier, the entire score would have simply been redone if they had been given just one more week to do so. Harvey Weinstein would also contract the song What's This Life For by the rock band Creed to be featured in the film and play over the end credits. The final piece of music heard in the film, John Carpenter's classic Halloween theme, was taken directly from that film's most recent CD release. Ottman was naturally displeased with these actions, making Halloween H20 his one and only attempt at the franchise to date. Fortunately, his working relationship with Steve Miner would survive, and the composer would move over to Lake Placid following H20. Because of this debacle, no official soundtrack would ever be released for the film. But in October 1998, just 2 months after its release, Ottman would debut a compilation album of his original music, titled Portrait of Terror, distributed under the Verisay Saraband label. The single CD set not only included Ottman's complete original score, but also offered several other unused and alternative cues for the film.
Ronnie, the phones are out.
And there's a strange car parked down at the gate, but I can't seem to find any signs of trespassing. What's
What are you doing?
Hey. I'm just gonna go find John.
Following preview screenings, the film would premiere in Los Angeles on August 5th, 1998, and Halloween H20 would see Dimension Films' marketing machine launch the increasingly niche franchise back into the mainstream, unleashing an onslaught of posters and TV spots in the weeks leading up to its release. Additionally, the Sci-Fi Channel, in partnership with Dimension Films, would produce an over 40-minute behind-the-scenes promotional documentary titled The Making of Halloween H20, hosted by Jamie Lee Curtis, and featuring a string of contemporary interviews and some behind-the-scenes footage. It would rake in an impressive $16 million in its opening weekend, playing in over 2,600 theaters across the United States, and running for a total of 21 weeks. With a domestic gross total of $55 million, the film would also see a smaller international run where it would take in an additional $20 million, for a total worldwide gross of $75 million, or $125 million today, making the seventh Halloween film the highest grossing entry in the entire franchise, not accounting for the lifetime gross of the original, of course, a position it would hold for two decades. The film would also claim the shortest runtime in the entire series, a fact that still stands today, running only 1 hour and 26 minutes. Critically, the film would receive mostly mixed reviews, with many at the time criticizing its predictability and comparing it unfavorably to John Carpenter's original, a common theme among critics of the franchise. Others, however, praised Jamie Lee Curtis's performance and saw the film as a celebration of the franchise's legacy, noting its many references to the 1978 film, and some even declaring it to be the best of the Halloween sequels. In the US, over a year after the film's premiere, it would hit the October 1999 home entertainment market in the form of a VHS and Laserdisc release from Buena Vista Home Entertainment. In the UK, the VHS would hit video stores on December 15, 1999, and would later see wide distribution across several other international territories. The film would simultaneously see its first DVD release from Dimension Films as part of the Dimension Collector Series DVD collection. The DVD would see its first premiere in the UK in 2001 and later re-released in 2011, in addition to a now-out-of-print 2004 UK DVD box set that featured the first eight films. Of course, not all home media editions of the film were of the utmost quality. In spring 2011, the film would infamously be released in the US on both DVD and Blu-ray by Echo Bridge Home Entertainment. The DVD version not only awkwardly altered the film's original 2.351 aspect ratio to a 1.661 widescreen transfer, a version later redistributed by Echo Bridge in a Blu-ray triple feature, but also uses the wrong mask for the box art. And while it would make its Blu-ray premiere in Canada a year earlier from Alliance Entertainment, the Echo Bridge 2011 standalone Blu-ray would again inexplicably change the original aspect ratio, this time to a 16:9 open mat transfer, in addition to downmixing its sound to stereo from the original 5.1 theatrical mix. To the surprise of no one, home media critics gave these releases universally scathing reviews, calling the Blu-ray edition a mess on nearly every level. Thankfully, in 2014, it would at last get the royal treatment with the release of Anchor Bay and Scream Factory's complete franchise Blu-ray box set, a collection I've already covered thoroughly in my previous Halloween retrospectives. This release saw the film restored to its original 2.351 ratio and offered several original and vintage special features, including a new feature-length commentary track featuring Jamie Lee Curtis and director Steve Miner. As far as alternative cuts are concerned, in February 2003, fans would get a look at a never-before-seen version of the film aired on the FX network that featured unreleased alternative and extended footage, many of which came from deleted scenes. Additionally, there does exist an earlier work print that apparently includes some unused footage, although it is said to be much closer to the final film than the FX cut. Neither version has ever seen an official release.
Uh, You know, I mean, I have a couple other movies where people like the movies a lot. But I don't think people remember the name of the character. The character was just kind of this person. I don't think you know very much about this person. Laurie Strode was the first movie I got to do. And, you know, even as I got success in other areas, I always, you know, looked back very fondly on playing her, because you knew who she was. You know, you just completely got it. And
in a 2018 interview with Variety magazine, Jamie Lee Curtis said that Halloween H20 had begun with the best of intentions, but that it eventually devolved into another studio money grab. And today, she considers the film to be nothing more than a paycheck movie. In the feature-length audio commentary for the 2014 Blu-ray, Curtis states that, for her, the film begins at 1 hour and 9 minutes in, when Laurie moves to finally face off with Michael. Following the release of H20, Jamie Lee Curtis would receive her long-overdue star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. As for writer Robert Zappia, like Daniel Farren's before him, he would submit one last contribution to the Halloween mythos in the form of a treatment for a direct sequel to H20 that would avoid many of the pitfalls of the actual follow-up. In Zappia's proposed continuation, Michael is, as was planned, revealed to have survived by switching clothes with a paramedic, but is apprehended and put on trial. However, Michael inevitably escapes and seeks revenge on those who have wronged him, namely an ensemble cast consisting mostly of stars from the previous films. Unfortunately for Zappia and Halloween fans, the studio took things in a different direction. Halloween H20, 20 years later, is a film that, today, certainly divides fans, some finding its fast-paced storytelling and pulse-pounding thrills to be a refreshing take on the often slow burn terror seen in the series, while others see it as a messy experimental offshoot that betrays the tone and sensibilities of Carpenter's original. Personally, I feel the film's biggest sin is its reliance on easy jump scares, which of course are always accompanied by a big loud, and most of which are total fake-outs, which always cheats the audience. The title itself is also a little silly, and really the product of a 1990s marketing fad that gave event movies slick nicknames like ID4, MI2, and MIB. I remember seeing the poster in movie theaters as a kid and thinking it took place on a ship or a submarine. Although the pH balance of water is about 7, so maybe it was clever? No matter where you fall on the film, it is undeniable that Jamie Lee Curtis delivers a powerful performance as a matured Laurie Strode, still traumatized by her deadly encounter with her brother. And the film's penultimate scene, where Laurie beheads Michael, is one of the best moments of the entire franchise, and perhaps the best ending of the series overall, maybe rivaled by Jamie Lloyd and a bloody pair of scissors at the conclusion of Part 4. But to just, supposedly, end such a revered property on something as blunt and final as a single-swing decapitation and then cut to credits is quite the bold choice. I myself prefer to pretend that this was all we got, wrapping up a nice little Laurie Michael trilogy that unburdened itself of the baggage left behind by the previous entries. While I definitely enjoy those films for their bizarre and unexpected contributions to the mythology, they eventually become too bogged down by the burden of having to convince the audience that it was all planned from the beginning. The supporting performances are also strong, especially from a mostly unknown young cast, and director Steve Miner certainly brings that early slasher movie charm to the film's more suspenseful moments. While the movie is obviously not bloodless, it is also not nearly as brutal as some of the shape's previous sprees, or ones yet to come, and utilizes shadow and wide angles in such a way that, as Curtis and Miner had set out to accomplish, feels closer to the 1978 film. And when it comes to Halloween sequels, that's about as much a fan could ask for.
Mr. Sandman.
Yes?
Bring us a dream, give him a pay.
So let me know what you think of Halloween H20. Is it a franchise favorite or a swing and a miss? And which of Laurie Strode's returns do you prefer most, this film or Halloween 2018? And as always, everyone, thank you so much for watching. If you like this video, go ahead and click like below and feel free to share. And don't forget to find me on Patreon at /LeightonEversole, where you'll gain early access to my channel's content and more. And of course, if you want to see more videos just like this one, go ahead and click subscribe.
They've known just what to do. Their souls are lost because